We are exploring the future of the human body and what our bodies and brains will be able to do come 2050.
All in a day's work.
Could mind-controlled robot suits help end some disabilities as we know them and lead the way to super strength? Let's find out. This is Future You with me, Elise Hu.
Dun-da-da-da.
Good.
Just within the past few years, researchers have figured out how to let paralyzed people walk in robotic bodysuits simply by thinking about it. It sounds like science fiction, but using our brain signals to operate machines is something that's not only possible, but improving quickly. Neuroscientists say the promise of this means that the millions of people who are paralyzed from the waist down have the potential to regain mobility if the technology becomes accessible. It's promising for people like 10-year-old Savion, who has never been able to walk. I asked him what life is like in the fourth grade.
I like reading, talking to my friends, and I might get a new girlfriend one day.
A new one?
Well, I mean, a girlfriend.
His mom named him after Savion Glover, a famous tap dancer. But he can't use his legs. He was born with the spinal cord defect, spina bifida. To get up on his feet, he wants to try a mind-controlled robotic exoskeleton. But they're only in research labs right now. So the only way he can is if he's accepted into a grant-funded study.
What excited you about these?
That I could get kicked back, guys.
Now that he's older, he's asking questions, you know, like about him being in a wheelchair. And I was like, you know, Savion, you know, it's going to make people different. You know, different. So he's questioning, you know, why he's in a wheelchair and stuff like that.
Do you still hope that he can dance one day?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Within the past few years, scientists have developed brain-machine interfaces that allow paralyzed people to use a robotic arm to touch a loved one for the first time in years or eat a piece of chocolate, as you're seeing in this clip. Robotic exoskeletons go further. They let paralyzed people get up on their feet and walk around. But first, you have to train to power these things with your mind, which I get to do in my home state of Texas. Okay, it's on Google Maps. So once we're set, I mean, we're just gonna drive that way.
That's right.
Scientists and engineers at the University of Houston are trying to help the actual future, children. They specialize in pediatric robotic limbs. Just like I'm about to do, the children learn how to make these robots move with their minds.
Here we are.
Hi, I'm Pepe.
Oh, it's nice to finally meet you.
How are you? Thanks for coming.
Oh, thank you for welcoming us. We're so excited to check all this out.
Oh, hi.
Out.
Hi, guys.
This is the lab of Dr. Jose Contreras-Vidal and his research team.
Hey, Andrew. Elise Hu.
Oh, David.
Nice
to meet you.
Sorry, I'm a little chilly.
I'm Ryan.
Hey, Ryan, Elise. Before we came, the guys asked for my head circumference. They are going to put this sexy cap on. Check out my bonnet.
So this is probably the extent of how it's going to feel.
Okay, great.
At least from the needle standpoint.
I mean, this feels as normal as getting gel injected onto 64 nodes of your head.
The researchers are connecting me to a brain-computer interface or brain-machine interface. Here's how it works. Think of brain-machine interfaces as a communication link between brain and device. They decode the neural activity in your brain and then use that data to control external devices, machines. Part of the interface can be surgically implanted, or it can be non-invasive. You plug in by wearing a cap. The external device our brains can control in this case is a robotic exoskeleton.
Oh, something's happening. Whoa.
This EEG cap reads the electrical activity from my brain associated with movement. To separate the walk signal from my brain from all the other noise these caps can read, I'm training the computer and its algorithms to know what the signals look like when I intend to move.
So we're in the data collection phase before I control it with my mind.
On the first beep, I concentrate on thinking about moving. On the next beep, I think about stopping. We do this until the robot learns to obey me. Which brings us to...
Elise tries.
This is the moment that I actually have to control the exoskeleton, my robot suit, with my mind. I don't know if I can do this because I've never done anything like this before. All right, here we go.
just worked perfectly.
I did it! No, that was awesome.
Great.
Yeah, it's like, so. It feels like a superpower. A lot of performance anxiety. Okay. All right.
As always, we're curious about where this technology could go. So we asked Attila to play In the Year 2050, BMI edition.
In the year 2050.
To go through this exercise, we asked him to give us four super scenarios for the world 30 years from now. First up, what's a superhuman ability that might be possible in the year 2050?
The exoskeletons will improve. It's unavoidable. It's like the cell phone. I mean, you used to carry a cell phone, which is like 10 kilograms weight, and then now it's on your back pocket, right? And it's wireless. If you're a firefighter and if you need to lift something really heavy and save lives, then why not? By all means, go ahead and, you know, augment the human capability there.
Where do humans end and where do machines begin? Where's the line?
Well, you know, that's a very, very hard question. I guess it's a reserved question for philosophers.
Fair enough, Attila. Fair enough. So we took the question to Duke University professor Dr. Miguel Nicolelis. He's not a philosopher, but is one of the fathers of brain-machine interfaces. He's pioneered invasive or implanted brain-machine interfaces for years. In 2014, he showed off a breakthrough. He developed a non-invasive brain-machine interface that let a paraplegic person kick off the World Cup in a robotic exoskeleton. He gets to pick up where Attila left off. What about this super thorny blur of humans and machines?
Our brain is extremely malleable. In the studies where we did this control of robotic arms, in a few hours, this robotic arm was being assimilated by the brain of the subjects as an extension of the sense of self, an extension of the body of the subjects. That is affecting the definition that the brain creates for our own bodies, our own sense of self. What is the border that calls us human, you know, that defines us as human, that we are willing to cross? I'm not so sure that I want to cross the final border.
What's a super villain possibility?
The weaponization of the brain, of using brain-machine interfaces to control new weapons or new types of devices that can harm large numbers of people. So I would hate to see this move into a domain where it has primarily military applications.
And what's super likely to happen with this technology?
You're going to see people walk in New York with an exoskeleton controlled by their brain. And you are not going to know that they were victims of a spinal cord injury, because, you know, they'll be walking side by side with you and crossing the traffic lights and being run over by cars, you know, in New York, as all of us are.
This is where we wanted to show you footage of Savion walking in an exoskeleton for the very first time. But the Houston team didn't get the research grant to custom 3D print an exoskeleton for him. The one I tried was for adults only. So I gave him a call to see how he was feeling.
I had an appointment for a therapist. Then he came and said they didn't have the money for the robot leg, and they said they're going to keep trying.
What did you say?
I feel a little bit sad and disappointed.
Well, we're really bummed out, too, to learn that the money didn't come through. We're really hopeful that something works out.
Thank you.
And we'll check in on you again.
Goodbye.
And that's the current reality for this technology. Today, for Savion and his family, the future feels far away. But researchers are hoping advancements come fast. That's where we are right now, deliberating the wonder of these discoveries, but also their weight. We hope you'll follow the future along with us, with Future You episodes dropping monthly. You can get them fresh by subscribing to NPR on YouTube or by going to npr.org/futureyou. Okay, we'll see you next time.
I'm about to lose my sexy hat.
All right, ready for this to come off?
All right, goodbye.
It's a weird feeling.
Goodbye. Oh. Now you can't read my thoughts anymore.
I'm sorry.
This has been an unusual day at work, but I have such a sense of accomplishment about it. Oh, my mind control.